The broadcast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello everybody and welcome to today's webinar. I'm joined today by Paul Gerrard of Gerrard Consulting Limited, and Paul is also our conference chair this year for the EuroSTAR conference in 2014, and today he's going to be presenting a new model for testing. If you have any questions about this webinar, or if you want to just give some feedback on this topic, you can do over on Test Huddle. And Test Huddle is our new software testing community. We have a discussion set up for this webinar, and let me just share the link with you now. So in your chat box, you should have a link there that will bring you right into this discussion. But also, if you just visit testhuddle.com, you will see that the discussion there will be featured at the top of the page. So as soon as the webinar is over, let's head over there and see what questions there are coming through. So now I'm going to hand you over to Paul. Hello, Paul.
Hi, Dara. How are you doing?
Great, great.
Okay, so let's... that look okay?
Yep, that's perfect.
Thanks a lot. Okay, well, firstly, thanks to the EuroSTAR team for asking me to do a webinar today. The topic for the day is this new model for testing that I've been working on, well, I think actively for the last 2 or 3 months, but probably passively for years and years, it seems to me. So I want to walk you through some of the thinking behind it and expose it to you, if you like, and just try and give you a sense of where I'm coming from. And I'm really hoping that you'll give some feedback, because I want to see whether it actually has legs, whether it will work, whether I can make use of it, because as all models go, it's wrong, but it might be useful. So with that perspective, let me make a start. Well, there's my marketing. I'll skip that fairly quickly. Now, before I get going, I just want to set the scene, really, from the point of view of the job market. About May 2014, a couple of months ago, I was browsing the Software Testing Club website and came across this job advert. And if you look at it, it's an interesting kind of set of skills, isn't it? So the sort of things that stand out are, well, thorough C-sharp knowledge, good .NET, building, maintaining automation, interaction with developers, ability to influence to ensure good test procedures developed and implemented, fine, desirable skills, Java, and an interest in photography. Well, it's an interesting advert because nowhere does it say, you know, anything to do with hands-on testing or test design or that kind of thing. It seems to be a tester job spec that doesn't have much testing in it. And I wonder, and it occurs to me, that is this typical? Is this the way the world is going? I think it isn't in general, but there's a growing trend towards more technically oriented testers and a growing trend towards what I've called and other people call assurance, which is overseeing testing as much as doing the job. But it's quite clear in this job that it's an interesting and a curious set of skills, perhaps. I should say it's to do with, it's for a company who are building products associated with wearable computing and the Internet of Everything, Internet of Things, that kind of stuff, which clearly is an emerging kind of part of our industry. But I wanted to set the scene with that because I do believe that these changes, this trend, is not going to go away, and it seems to be accelerating, and it started a few years ago, and it's only getting faster. So I want to kick the session off with this background of what are the pressures for us to change the way we think about testing. And I want to talk about thinking about testing as opposed to doing the job so much. As is my wont, I tend to do that. I want to talk about three. There are many innovations, but I want to talk about three innovations, let me call them, that are driving or maybe responsible or maybe associated with or inevitable with the changes that are happening in our industry. I want to speculate on where this is leading and make a kind of a stark conclusion that I came to some months ago, which just made me think that something new, some new thinking was required, and in particular, my head started working on this new model for testing, which I'll explain in the second half of this session. And having set out what this model is, I want to sort of explore some of the consequences and maybe uses as well. That little final bullet, a shift left is more important than agile, is a little bit of debris from another presentation. Perhaps I should have taken it out. But there is a slide. I don't want to spend much time on that, except to say shift left may be more important than agile. I'll explain that towards the end. So what's happening out there? Well, you know, change is always there. It's our industry has always been in this state. You know, some illustrations, you know, which I'm sure you're aware of and familiar with, are there's this notion of mobile computing, which is there's a stampede towards putting everything into mobile devices. Big data seems to have emerged in the last year or two. The Internet of Things, which is a really fascinating area that, for myself in particular, and the Internet of Everything. I mean, it's staggering what is likely to be the case in the next 5 or 10 years. We have 5 to 7 billion devices on the Internet now. In 10 years, 20 years, maybe there are 1,000 billion devices. It's staggering growth, you know, a 100-fold growth in the scale of what we're working with. Of course, most of these devices will be very tiny and maybe throw away and cost a few pennies or cents. But even so, the whole notion of the Internet in the future is undergoing a huge change, but it's a very quiet change for most people. But the big players are working incredibly hard on this. Part of that Internet of Everything, Internet of Things, is the notion of pervasive computing, which has been talked about for many years, but is becoming a reality more and more, and wearable computing. We're all wearing heart monitors and wristbands and so on and so forth to capture statistics on our bike rides or runs or swims or whatever. It's becoming part of our life, and all these things are collecting data. Now, the companies that are delivering systems on the back of mobile device and so on are tending to be working in continuous delivery in DevOps environments. This is becoming more and more the norm in certain sectors of our industry. Part of the notion of devices everywhere, and mobile in particular, are the huge quantities of diagnostic and analytic data that's being captured by servers when they are accessed by users through mobile devices, the internet, whatever. I want to talk briefly about something called test analytics, which is an extension of, if you like, web analytics, which is quite well understood now. And there's now a notion, I think Microsoft are beginning to talk about something called data-driven development, which is almost ship a product and drive development through the data you collect in a production environment. So rather than you speculating on what the business needs, you actually take data from your production systems and use that to infer requirements in the future. I mean, I think it's early days, but it's an interesting development. Perhaps more familiar is there's an increasing trend towards shift left and embedding testers, moving them from independent teams. And some companies are made a commitment to have no independent testers. I don't think that's very common yet, but the thinking is out there, the motivations are out there to make serious changes in the way we do testing. Now it might be easy and lazy perhaps to say, well, this is just the agile community just making progress. Well, I don't think it's as simple as that. I think agile was transitional. I think agile may have peaked, and these changes are still happening, and the way we build systems is still moving. It's a moving kind of target. So I think agile, I'll talk about that briefly in a moment, but I don't want to give the impression that it's just more agile. It's not. I think there's something else going on. So I want to illustrate some of these changes and the challenges to us with some examples of the innovations that are driving change, and these are being agile, shift left, analytics. So I'm going to talk for a moment or two on each one of these. And the first one, let me say this, agile doesn't work, but being agile might. I think the belief that agile could solve every problem is kind of foolish, but not many people believe that. But there's a whole industry has sprung up about agile practices and selling agile practices and trying to implement agile with a capital A practices, that people now understand what Scrum and stand-ups and rapid feedback and these components of Agile. People now understand that, okay? And the challenge isn't to adopt these kind of practices. The challenge really is to be an agile organization so that you make decisions on how you work. Let me just explain for a moment what I mean by agile doesn't work. It works for some, it works for many perhaps, but also many organizations have had difficulties. They've attempted agile in the context of their business world, and it's pretty much a cultural problem in that trying to embed agile teams in a non-agile business is easier said than done. I mean, we've all met, and you may be part of a team that might say something like, we are agile, but we only meet our stakeholders once a month. We are agile, but we deliver big releases which are systematized by a team every 3 months. We are agile, but. And there's a lot of that going on. People are compromising what agile, pure agile is all the time, because agile cannot be dropped into the context of a, say, more traditional business very easily. So what happens, of course, is companies make use of what works and discard what doesn't. So most companies are using some kind of hybrid approach. And there may be a chaotic interface between agile teams and instruction businesses, but companies are making these things work. They believe, I think, in the main, that they are making progress. But they've not stopped changing. And agile isn't a destination, agile with a small I. Agile is a philosophy, it's a mentality, a way of thinking. And I think people are recognizing that actually being agile with a little bit is what it's really about. So how you implement your processes is really about how you make use of what's best for you in your context. Now, part of the changes that seem to be increasing in popularity is this idea of shift left. And you know, I've called it in the past redistributed testing. It doesn't matter what it's called, but shift left is one label for suggesting that maybe we move the focus of test from the end of our projects on whole systems to redistributing those test activities throughout our projects, throughout our teams, and maybe changing this notion of testing as a role to become testing as an activity that happens throughout the lifecycle. Now, this is not new. I mean, you know, I remember saying 20-something years ago, you know, testing is all about testing through the lifecycle. Test early, test often. These are not new messages. These are very old messages. But it seems like Agile has kind of created a, it's kind of catalyzed this kind of thinking and changed towards a shift left, a redistributed test. So the kind of changes are getting developers to take more responsibility, embedding testers into development teams, maybe implementing a no test team structure. So let me just walk through. Let's call it a thought experiment. And this is just something I want you to consider, and maybe this is the kind of thinking that is beginning to emerge and might be happening in your environment. So let's just walk through it and kind of rehearse the conversation perhaps. If you look at my very simple process here, I've got function requirements, we've got build, not much testing, but lots of rework as a development process, and testing with lots of checking and bugs. And of course, we have the feedback loops to find bugs in the software and maybe misunderstandings and complexities in requirements that weren't envisaged. So we have these big feedback loops, and of course, there's lots of rework. So let me compare that with, let me say, another ideal situation, but where on the left we have this process that generates, let me call them trusted requirements and stories, and I'll explain that in a moment. We have the middle process, which is a behavior-driven environment where developers take stories in structured text, generate test code, and use that to drive, to feed, if you like, a test-driven development process. And then we have testing on the right, as before. What we can say is the feedback in here is that if our requirements are better, we shouldn't find as many challenges in development in the requirements as we did before. And when it comes to testing, the feedback loop, you know, simple trivial bugs found by testers to be fixed by the developers. Again, that should be reduced. How does this work? Well, it's essentially, we take some of the effort in testing and redistribute it and bring it up front into the requirements piece. So when a requirement is written, or when a requirement is captured as a story on a wall chart, on a yellow sticky or something, the tester or someone with a testing discipline will challenge that requirement through example. Now those examples can be captured in structured text in the form of stories, maybe in a Gherkin format, and the process of requirement solicitation and validation happens in that left-hand box. So the quality of the requirements that comes out of that process is improved. Now part of that deliverable is stories, which can be used by the developers to drive their test-driven activity, test-driven development activity. So they would discover that many of the tests, the low-level tests that testers would have applied late, are actually applied as part of their test-driven activities. So the number of stupid bugs, let's call them, for want of a better label, should be reduced in the development process itself. Now the investment of time, and I'm not sure whether this will come up on the very well on the webinar screen, but there's a shift. The green bars is a shift in the effort from late testing into early requirements validation, and the red areas are time saved, let us say. Now, if we take those resized boxes and drop them into the third layer here, you see that the overall profile is different. We have a bigger requirements piece, a smaller development piece, and a much smaller development testing piece. Now, I've not given you any metrics. I'm not going to justify it with any case studies. I'm just setting this out as a thought experiment to suggest that the thinking that is behind shift left is to save time at the end by investing some of the late tester discipline and effort and redistributing it into the development teams and to business analysis or design areas. Now, is it a tester who's actually going to physically move from one place to another, or is it someone who's going to pick up that test activity and perform it? I don't have anything to say on that. I mean, I think that's a local decision to be made by the company or organization. But the thinking is clear, to redistribute testing to reduce the overall end-to-end time. Now, part of that notion of faster delivery is to take it to extreme, and you've probably heard of continuous delivery, and understand that a continuous delivery or DevOps environment might be shipping software into a production environment every week, every 2 or 3 days, every day, every hour even. So the whole process of delivery is transformed into a very rapid series of end-to-end developments. So you can see that continuous delivery is about very short, very tightly scoped developments. Part of this whole idea of continuous delivery is it requires extremely high discipline and a very high level of automation. I haven't got time to talk about that in detail now, but I just want to suggest that continuous delivery as a mechanism is something that companies who have never known any other way would not change at all. So companies, the biggest companies on the planet perhaps, the Amazons, the eBays, the Googles and so on, these organizations almost have always had a continuous delivery regime and philosophy. They don't know any different. But startups are finding it an easier or a potentially easier way to work. But even bigger companies are beginning to think along these lines, where very rapid deployments and deliveries might help them to achieve their business goals. Now, one thing to say is that although you might be delivering into a production environment on a daily basis, you might not actually be turning the software on and actually releasing it to end users. There's a whole different set of disciplines associated with dot releases and A/B testing and so on and so forth. So I don't want to go into that, but it's not as clear cut as it would appear as in terms of daily releases, into production environment, fully committed, very risky. It's not like that. Now, part of a continuous delivery regime would be that it's partly driven by data collected in the production environment. Now, and you've almost certainly heard of web analytics, which can be used to see where users are using your system in production and what patterns of behavior they're exhibiting. So, and using that information to tell you more about your own system. Now, I think you can extend that from production and bring it back into your development world. Because if you're in a continuous delivery mode, and a lot of the testing you're doing is automated with respect to it being applied in an automated fashion, designed by humans, run by tools, the statistics captured in your continuous integration regime and the tools that are running your tests, the potential is there to capture very similar data to the data that's being captured in your production environment. Now, I'm not saying there's a guaranteed relationship between the two, or that the data collected in your production, in your development and test regime, will always be of great value and give you fantastic insights. But the potential is there. It's a big data problem. It's complicated, messy, unstructured data. Very often, can we make sense out of it? Well, I'm beginning to think that in some environments this is the case. So I wrote a paper middle of last year called Introducing Test Analytics, which kind of set out some of these ideas. A good friend of mine, Julian Harty, who's also a keynote at EuroSTAR in November, of course, he gave a fantastic talk with a rather interesting title, Symbiotic Relationships Between Testing and SMAC. SMAC being the social, mobile, analytics and cloud. So a very similar set of ideas. Julian has a background with working with companies like eBay and Salesforce, and he's in that space. So bear that in mind. So now, where does that lead us? It's all very well saying that change is inevitable, change is continuous, there's stuff happening out there which is a little bit scary because it doesn't fit the way I work. Where's all this headed? Well, I can't possibly say that. I wish I knew. I'd be a billionaire if I could give you that answer. But I want to suggest, firstly, that continuous isn't the same as agile. I think although it seems to be emerging out of agile organizations, I think it's a different set of disciplines. And I haven't the time to go into detail here, but I created a model of the three patterns. And my suggestion is that agile and structured, waterfall, if you like, they do have some things in common. So they are both, let me summarize in just a couple of words, goal-based. They're very focused on an end goal. How you get there is different, but they are very goal-driven. Agile and continuous are much more focused on delivery, but through autonomous teams as opposed to very top-down structured hierarchies. But there's a big commonality between structured and continuous in that structured is high process, but then so is continuous because much of it is automated. It has to be very highly disciplined, very high process. So there are parallels between waterfall, structured, and continuous as well. Now, I don't want to dwell on this except to say, well, okay, there's the three development patterns, make of it what you will. Except, I don't think there are just three patterns. I think what's beginning to emerge in the companies that I've been talking to in the past couple of years is there is no one pattern, and it's not just agile versus structured, and it's not, okay, we'll continue. It seems to be that it's the right thing to do to adopt a hybrid approach that suits your environment, context, scenario, situation, call it what you like. It seems to me that the world is moving from high process, waterfall world, and that agile was a transient situation almost, to from high process to do-it-yourself process. So you figure out your hybrid approach yourself in your own world. You could almost say it's context-driven, I could say. The issue we had in the past was that technical people and most IT folk are kind of technically oriented. High process was seen as a solution to the software problem, but the software problem isn't a technical problem. It's a people problem, and process as a technical solution cannot solve human problems. So Agile has really shaken up our world, of course, but I think it's an interim kind of situation. I think we're moving towards true agility with a small a, where teams can adapt and select and evolve its process on the fly, depending on circumstances. And that seems to me to be a different situation than we were in 2 or 3 years ago, or 5 or 10 or 20 years ago. Now, if that's the case, that we are moving into a world where every company does it differently, which is kind of what we've always known, but never thought of as a good situation, it could be that if every company is going to work differently and evolve its own and have ownership of its own approach and evolve its own approach, that the old ways of testing, the old testing ways, won't work in the future. So the very high levels of process, staged, highly documented, planned, scripted, blah, 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 all the stuff that might be, you know, archetypal certification kind of style process, that doesn't work in Agile, but that certainly won't work in a continuous delivery environment. By the same token, freelance, independent, autonomous team given free rein to explore in their testing and never write things down. I mean, I don't think many people ever do that, but that doesn't seem to be appropriate either. It doesn't seem to fit. So there needs to be some process, but a flexible process, and some capture of outcomes of testing and interpretations of testing and maybe plans of testing, but it varies wherever you go. And it seems to me that there's no one size fits all, but what we've had in the past are two extremes, you know, total documentation and planning, and hardly any documentation, planning, and so on. It seems to me that we've kind of got ourselves in a situation where we've only got two clubs in our bag rather than one, but we need 15. And I'm not sure the way people think about testing will work the same way in the future. So I think we need a new way of thinking of testing. I've called it a new model. I've called it a new model partly because it's new, you might say, but partly it's a marketing label. Of course, everything sounds better when it's new, you could argue. But I want to say this, that it's just a way of thinking about testing without reference to all the stuff I'm going to call logistics. Strip away the logistics and the model and the way we think as testers, I think it becomes much simpler. And this is what I want to walk you through. I've been working on this for probably several months, 5 or 6 months maybe, but talking about it for the last 2, maybe 3 months now. And I've given talks to, I think, about 6 or 7 different audiences across Europe, and a couple of multinationals as well. And people have been very positive about it. I'm very grateful for that. It runs short of being useful for anything, I think, but I think it has the potential for something. So I want to talk about the potential. Now, before I start, I need to make a couple of statements. First thing is, we need to forget logistics. What are logistics? Logistics are whether you document or not. Do you write things down, or you work from mental models? Are you agile or waterfall? Do you plan, or do you explore in a free format way? Do you use this technology or that technology? These things, I do not care. Strip away all the logistics. Strip away everything to do with documentation, structure, process, planned scripting versus exploratory, automation, whatever technology. Strip all that away, and what is left? That is the basis of the model. Now, underpinning all testing, here's my suggestion, that all testing is exploratory. Take away the logistics, and what you're left with is an activity, a process that has two kind of modes. But the three phrases beneath, you know, the bottom of this slide are probably the most important thing in the whole deck. This is what I'm trying to suggest we do as testers. We explore sources of knowledge. From those sources of knowledge, we build test models, and those test models inform our testing. And let me walk you through the process. Now, before I go too much further, I need to talk about models, because some of you will know very clearly what I'm talking about in terms of modeling and test models in particular. But some of you might not be so familiar with this idea. And yet it's very old, and it goes way back 30 years to the way we think about testing. All testing is based on models. Now, if we were in a class, I'd be asking the class what these models are in these examples. So let me just show you them. First one, what's that? Well, it's a sequence diagram, I think, UML. So those of you who use UML, you'd recognize that as kind of a way of managing and documenting and describing the handoffs between different roles, different actors in a system. What's that? Ah, the Microsoft project. Oh, no. Gantt chart, project schedule. Okay, it's a model. It's not reality. It's a model of reality. It's a prediction and a model of how a software or any project will roll out. But it's a model of reality, not the real thing. Some project managers take that too seriously. This one, hand-drawn, who cares? It's an entity model. It's a description of the data relationships between entities in a system. What's that? It's a weather chart. We all know the weathermen, meteorologists use supercomputers to model climates, to make predictions of the weather for the farmers, for shipping, for you and me when we're looking at next week's activity on our holidays. It's a model. It's not reality. Now, this is the fun one. I wonder if any of you know what this is. It's actually the Paul Dirac equation of the electron. It's a model of the behavior of the electron in mathematics. It's a model. Of course, those of you who've been to London, or the British folk in the audience, you recognize that as the London Underground map. Now, is that an accurate map of the underground stations on the underground system in London? No, of course not. It's wrong. It's completely wrong. It bears no relation to the physical reality on the ground. But is this model useful? Of course it is, in order to plan your journey across London. What's this? I mean, those of you who did a little bit of maths at school might see it as it's a block on a slope with friction, and the little triangle, the vector diagram to the right, is a model of the forces in equilibrium. Okay, it's a model. Engineers use models all the damn time. So what can we say about this? Well, the models I've kind of walked you through, I just want to suggest that they are pervasive. They're everywhere. And we all use them, but they're not just for mathematicians or physicists or weathermen or engineers. Models are innate, essential, and human. And by that I mean, imagine you're thirsty and there's a glass of water a few meters away. As you make your way from your current position towards the glass of water to pick it up, your brain is modeling your environment, the structure of your body, the status of all the muscles that control your movement, and your brain is calculating and recalibrating your model as your brain sends impulses to your muscles, which allow you to move from one end of the room to the other without falling over, without bumping into anything, without tripping up. And then with every step you take, your brain is recalculating, recalibrating, until you pick up the water, hold it to your lips, and take a drink without spilling the water. Now, your brain and its way of working in terms of modeling is fantastically complex and sophisticated. And I can't possibly explain that. I don't know if anyone else can on the planet yet. But we know your brain is doing that. We know our brains are fantastic engines for making models, for using models. So models are not for scientists and PhDs. Models are for everyone. Okay, so now I need to introduce the model of testing. And I want to suggest that there are two main phases or modes of thinking in our test. Firstly, we do some exploration. We explore sources of information. And we take those sources and we create models. And as we explore, we model. And at some point, we decide our models are satisfactory, are adequate, are good enough in order for them to inform something we'll call testing. So we transition from exploring and model making to using models to inform our testing. So we have these two phases, exploring on the left, testing on the right. Now we know from the testing we do that sometimes it turns out our models are inadequate, they're wrong. All models are wrong, some are useful. Sometimes we need more models, sometimes we need to refine our models. So we need to move from the right, the testing phase, back into exploring. And we have this kind of cyclic activity, and our brains can do this almost without us thinking. And I'm not suggesting that I understand how these processes work, but I think these processes exist, and that's the point. Now, how do we make decisions about whether we transition left to right or right to left? I can't tell you exactly how that happens. I could guess, but I don't think it's important to know too precisely. But I do know we use our judgment, our experience. So with that, I'm going to explain the model as a whole in two phases. I'm going to talk about exploring first, and then I'm going to talk about testing. And then I'm going to bring the two together and show you the model in its entirety. As a little aside, could it be that in the exploration side of this activity, is that how developers think? Because I am a developer, I happen to believe the answer is yes, that actually developers explore in a very similar way to testers. Their goal may not be to do testing, their goal may be to identify features to create and to implement in code, but I think the thought process of exploration is probably very similar. I'll come back to that in a little bit. So let's talk about exploration. We have our sources, and our source could be people, could be documentation, it could be standards, it could be the system under test itself, it could be the previous system, it could be models given to us. We explore, we inquire, we ask questions of those sources. So we could ask questions of an individual to understand what the requirements are, perhaps. We might ask questions of a document, in a review, or we might make notes and then challenge our users, perhaps. But we inquire, we ask questions, and we explore. From that, we model. We make models. Now, those models might be documented. They might be mental and never written down. They might be the whole inquiry modeling might take place in a few seconds. It might take months or years. There's no concept of timing on this because the timing is basically dependent on the logistical process you follow, whether you are staged, planned, or just exploratory. Okay, so we make our models. When we create our models, we can use those models to predict. We can now infer the behavior of our system from our sources of knowledge and our models, and we can challenge our sources. So an example would be we read a requirement. We sketch out some stories, some examples. We feed those examples back to our users and say, is this how the system works? And the user might say, that's exactly right, or that's exactly wrong, or I've not explained this very well, or you've misunderstood, or I need to go away and rethink this because you've exposed a flaw in all our thinking. Who knows? But there's a cycle involved of inquiry, modeling, predicting, challenging, to refine the requirement, whether it's documented or it's on a yellow sticky or it's simply a verbal request. We challenge our requirements and we end up with trusted requirements as an outcome. Okay, so from there I'm going to go to the, to the testing process. So given the models that we've created on the left-hand side of the previous slide, let's move along to the right. In this case, we can take our models and we can use them to inform our testing. And by that I mean the model might be, as a common example, a state transition diagram. we can take the state transition diagram and select test cases from the diagram directly. Our model might be a list of risks or a list of design heuristics. We can use these lists, these inventories, if you like, to drive the generation of tests and designs. Having created a test, we apply it. And I've used that word very particularly because I don't want to... applying includes running a test by hand, by humans. It could mean using a tool, or it could be any combination. And most tests are kind of hybrid efforts between people and technology. But we apply a test, and applying the test includes the checking of the outcome. You know, does it pass, fail, or do something else entirely? We apply it to the system of the test, of course. Now, the outcome of that test might be pass, fail, or something really weird. Who knows? I can't possibly predict. But the interpretation of that is something that I will argue that only humans can do. Applying could be humans or tools. Interpreting, humans only. Only people can do the interpretation. What does this mean? Now, from our interpretation, it might be, yeah, we can log a bug. And maybe the system is changing. I've included that. That's not part of the test process, in the thinking process in my world. And we could revise the system, go through that loop. I'm not going to spend any time on that. Certainly, we might report the outcomes, maybe an analysis of the outcomes to make some recommendation, of course. We might also take the thinking behind the testing and refine our models. So it's common for us to run a test and then say, you know what? We don't know enough about this system in order to test it yet. So we might have to go back and refine. And then again, we might have to say, wait a minute, we need to go back to our sources and be a bit more critical of our sources and understand more precisely what the requirement is. So there's a potential outcome of going back to exploration. So the testing process is basically that in a nutshell. Now, when you glue those three diagrams together, the model's not adequate, models are adequate, the exploration process and the testing process, you get something that looks like this. Now, it wasn't planned that way, and it's kind of symmetrical along the horizontal axis. It looks like some kind of chemical formula, or maybe some kind of strange-looking insect. I don't know. It is what it is. But you'll notice that all the thinking activities, inquiring, challenging, reporting, applying, whatever, each one of them can be separated out. Okay, I'm fairly certain that most, if not all, the activities we undergo, thought activities that testers take on and perform, are covered in the diagram, in the model. And that's kind of the position I want to take. Now, from that, you might say, okay, well, that's all very interesting as an academic exercise. Well, what use is it? Let me talk about perhaps some consequences of thinking this way. What could the model tell us? If the model isn't useful for anything, it is useless, and it's almost certainly wrong as a consequence. All models are wrong. Some models are useful. I want to explore what value, perhaps, we could get out of this way of thinking. The first one is, do developers and testers think the same way? I would suggest that the exploration process potentially is very similar. If we argue that that's the case, and we can discuss the thought processes with our developers and recognize that perhaps they're on the same wavelength in the exploration process, then actually there's a lot more commonality between what developers do and think and what testers do and think. Potentially, it could be an easier job to embed testers in development teams. Potentially, developers recognizing how they use the thinking they already do to help them with testing, perhaps their developer testing can improve. Does the model cover functional and non-functional? Well, the short answer is I don't know, but some obvious examples, I think, work just fine. So, you know, the performance and load, stress testing, certainly the functional aspects of security testing fit quite nicely into the model. They're fine. Usability? I don't know. But then again, perhaps usability testing done in a formal way, maybe that's the way the qualification, does match the way the model is laid out. More research is required in this area, I have to say. What's the relation of this way of thinking about testing and TDD, test-driven and behavior-driven development? In the paper, if you're interested in reading it, I'd really like you to take a look at it. I argue that test-driven development isn't really about testing. It's a mechanism for implementing the thinking to create designs for code and to demonstrate those designs work okay. I don't think that's a test process so much as a design process. BDD is different because the behavior-driven advocates nowadays promote the collaborative aspects of BDD far above the generation of test code. I think the generation of test code is potentially really valuable, of course it is, but it's the collaboration aspect, and BDD is very much more oriented towards what I would call now the exploration side of the testing model. So BDD, I think, fits very nicely with the model. How about testing with checking versus checking? Well, James Back and Michael Bolton have been working on this some time now, and I've come up with these definitions of testing and checking. They don't float my boat. They don't kind of work for me, because I think the main thing is I think there's an embedded activity called interpretation in the definition of both testing and checking. And I think there are other problems. And Ken Kay has kind of been quite strident in his criticism. I'm not sure what value the way that these things have been defined. I'm not sure it's helpful to me, but it's a model. It's wrong. It might be useful. In the same way, this model is wrong. It might be useful. I think my argument would be that I'm very comfortable in calling a check a test that could be applied by a human or a tool. Very simple definition. It's recognizable, understandable. It has its place. But only humans can interpret. I don't think interpretation is part of the application of a test. Now, one of the reasons that test automation in many environments fails, and fails badly in a very expensive way, is that a common attempt is to take existing functional tests and to implement them using test automation. That usually fails. It's a troublesome part of our industry. I want to suggest this, that the difference between an automated test and a test run by humans isn't the fact that it's run by a human or run by a tool. The difference is that it's got a different goal. And as a consequence, the models we use to design automated tests are slightly and subtly different from the models we might use to implement functional tests. Now, there's no time to explain that, but my suggestion is we should focus less on the tools versus people question and much more on the models used to design our automated or manual tests. What about developer testing? Well, I have to say, in a very deep-seated piece of research I've been doing for 30 years into my own activity as a developer, it works for me. I'm not a very big sample. It might not work for other developers, but the model is what it is because it seems to work for me. That's where it has come from. So I need to talk to more developers. Capabilities. And one of the things that the model throws up is this notion of skills, of course. You know, if you remove all the logistical baggage from testing as it is taught and learnt by many of us, and you are left with these thinking activities, these thinking processes, inquiry, modeling, predicting, challenging, and so on. What does that tell us? Well, if you look under the surface of what these thinking processes actually are, you come up with a whole series of different perspectives on the skills and capabilities that people need to do the job. So if this list here is something that is not well researched, I put it together in possibly less than an hour even, it's just a suggestion of the sort of skills that I think become more relevant to the thought processes because we have disregarded logistics. And you can see some interesting things come out here. Things like identification, validation, and use of oracles and models, the comparison of models, the creation of new techniques. So I want to suggest that a good test team might be creating 10 new test design techniques every day. We rely so much on the hackneyed test design techniques, but only learn them through rote. In fact, we don't learn modeling, we just learn how to follow a procedure. It's logistics. The test design techniques are usually taught as logistics. Now, I'm not trying to suggest that this is a definitive list, but you can see the notion of this set of skills is very different from the certified kind of syllabuses that you see. I want to justify this in just a few words. Shift left is more important than agile. It's more important than agile because whereas agile shook the industry up, shift left is now picking up the pieces and we're beginning to see a consolidation of thinking in terms of the way that we build software and systems. My argument is shift left is more important than agile because whereas agile challenged people, shift left is the reaction and we're now beginning to find ways. And shift left is one part of this process, I'm sure. But shift left is the outcome, as agile was as a means to that end, means to the outcome. We have to change some thinking. And I don't know if many people think this way, but I've certainly heard this. You know, developers write code, testers test because developers can't. Firstly, it's not true. Secondly, it's not a sensible thing to think. We have to move away from the us and them. We have to move away from the sense that testing is something that's done at the end. Part of the notion of behavior-driven development in particular is the notion of getting requirements into a better state, trusted if you like, before we use them to implement code. Part of that process is the creation of examples that can be used to generate test code to do automated feature-based checking. Why or why do we do this with people? Why don't we use tools to do this activity? We'll end up with better requirements, better software product, and less hassle for people at the end. I always end up saying this at some point in almost every talk, but we don't test at the end and we apply it to existing software. We test systems, not just software. We test early, we test often. But what you may find in your organization is that testing is being redistributed. You might not be called upon to do it. It might not be called testing, but it's there. The disciplines are there. There's been quite a debate on whether testers need to learn how to code. I'm not arguing whether you should or you shouldn't. I think as something to put on your CV, having coding skills cannot be a bad thing. But I think the notion of shift left, embedding testers, bringing testers into the automation piece earlier on, I think will require many testers to learn how to write good code. And did I say I've written a little book called Lean Python to help people to do that? One way of thinking about testing is about finding bugs, but it's so limited. I think we have to step up from thinking of testing that happens at the end, about finding bugs, about testers being servants to developers, rather to say that testing helps projects navigate their path through achievement. Testing isn't about measuring quality, it's about measuring achievement. Where we are in a sensible way using models that make sense. And if those models make sense to people on the board, you will have a seat on the board. We have to be brave. We have to think that testers don't own testing anymore. One argument I've been making for some time is to suggest that agile testing isn't about testing at all. It's about supporting the test activities within your team. You might do some hands-on testing, but more often it's about assuring the testing that's being undertaken within the team, giving advice, being a test master, you might say. So new model testing potentially changes what testers and developers need to learn. If it works this way and we strip out logistics, it becomes apparent that the certification schemes are almost 100% about logistics, not about the basics thinking processes of testers. So it's now easy to understand why a lot of people think that certification schemes do not make people into better testers. We need some new thinking in this area and trying to get that ball rolling. One last thing, one last message. The phase after development is rework, not testing. Imagine that you took out the last phase of your project called testing and replaced it with the activity rework. The project manager would go nuclear and say, what on earth is this doing on my project plan? It's there, it's misnamed. What testers do is we don't run that phase. We basically provide information for others to achieve the rework, to perform the rework. Calling that phase rework is calling a spade a spade. Now the issue we have then is if that phase is to be eliminated, we have to bring testing earlier in the life cycle, embed it within development and start testing earlier, even in requirements piece. We have to align with development, not compete with it or rescue it. And with that, I think I'm done. I'm sorry I took the full hour, carried away as usual. I'm very interested to hear if you have any comments on the paper. The paper, the link is there, and it's also on the discussion, the test circle site. So, Dara, if you're still there, I'll hand back to you.
Thank you very much, Paul. It was a very interesting webinar, and I'm just going to open up my screen here again. You should see my screen there now. Let me just share with you again one last time that link for the webinar, for the discussion. You should see the link there. And before we head over to Test Huddle to go through some of your questions, I just want to bring your attention to one or two things. First of all, there's a competition that we are running here called TeamStar. And it's the opportunity for a team of up to four testers to win a place at this year's conference in Dublin. And this prize is worth up to €7,100. To be able to chance of winning this prize, what you need to do is need to submit a short video which shows us a unique way of convincing your boss to let you go to EuroSTAR. And you can send that video to communications@eurostarconferences.com. And just need to point out as well that the closing date is August 15th, so you need to make sure you get your entry in early. And also, I want to bring to your attention an upcoming virtual conference that we're running called EuroSTAR Online. It's entirely free to attend, so we hope you can make it. And we have a whole host of renowned testers taking part from various testing fields, and you can see these testers right there. And we'll also have on the day as well a new and exclusive ebook from Bob Galen and Mary Thorne that you can download. And that's about it from me here. So let me just share again that link for the discussion. You can see the link there now. The webinar is now over, and I look forward to seeing what you guys had to say over on Test Huddle. Thank you again, Paul, and thanks everyone for attending.